Chapter 21, Attack and Counterattack. The morning after the trouble of the fountain, Dune awoke to a clamor rising through the window from the front of the hotel. He looked out, but he could see only the tops of people's heads all clustered around the front steps. He ran downstairs with his shirt still unbuttoned flapping around him to see what was happening. The doors of the hotel stood open. Through them, he saw that a heap of trash had been dumped on the front steps. He went closer and looked. The pile seemed to consist of rotten vegetables and filthy rags scattered all over the shiny green leaves and sharp twigs and long creepers pulled up by their dirty roots. Dune stared at it with the same sick feeling he'd had when he saw the black words on the hotel walls. It wasn't so much the pile itself that made him feel sick. It was that whoever did this hated the people of Amber and hated Dune himself in particular. This was an act of revenge. He went outside, edging around the pile. Clary was standing on the steps just below it, peering down at the leaves and branches. "Why would they bother to scatter leaves on everything?" she said. "And they're all the same kind, too." She picked up a sprig and looked closely at the bright green leaves, rubbing them between her fingers and sniffing them. "Strange," she said. "But most people were too upset to pay attention to the contents of the pile. An angry buzz filled the air, and now and then one voice or another rose above the rest. "This is an outrage." It was a clear, sharp voice. "Tix, Dune. Tix," Dune was sure. Then a high voice. "I hate them. I hate them." That must be Lizzie. And sure enough, there she was, standing near Tix, dunking her shoes in a bucket of water to get the dirt stains off. After a while, Tick climbed the steps and clapped his hands. "All right, everyone," he called. "We've been attacked again. And this is worse than the first time. It is a disgusting insult and it fills us with rage. But all we can do right now is get this mess off our doorsteps. Let's get busy and clean it up." Everyone did. They picked up armloads of leafy vines and carried them away. They shoved the garbage down onto the ground and kicked it into the bushes. They brought buckets of water up from the river and sloshed them over the steps until everything was more or less clean. Tix supervised all of this, calling out directions, though he didn't do any of the actual work himself. Dune noticed. "Doesn't want to get his clothes dirty," thought Dune, rather than grumpily. When the cleanup was done, people stood around and argued. Some were for marching down the town that very minute, confronting the town leaders and demanding that the vandals be punished. Other people said no, it wasn't good to cause trouble. It would just make everything more unpleasant, and always it wasn't the whole village that was against them, only some of them. "But which ones?" someone yelled. "And how do we stop them?" "They have to be stopped. I'm tired of being blamed and punished," cried someone else. "I'm tired of being starved. And what about winter?" someone yelled. The word spread, and people had added to this, had added this to their list of grievances. "Are we just going to sit here and take this treatment?" "No, no, no." Dune could see Tick moving through the crowd, bending to speak into the ear of one person and then another as people listened to. Their eyes narrowed and their lips tightened and they turned to Tick and nodded. The shouting died down after a while because people couldn't agree on a course of action. If they didn't go to work, they wouldn't get any lunch. So most of them went back to their ordinary routines. They washed their hands and faces in the river. They ate what remained in their parcels of breakfast and they headed up the road toward the village. Dune and his father went too, though Dune went reluctantly. "Father," he said, "this is the third time they've attacked us. Don't you think we have to do something?" "What do you propose to do?" his father said. "I don't know," said Dune. "But we have to do something. We can't just let ourselves be trampled, can we?" "Son," said Dune's father, "I don't know the answer. We're in a tough situation here." He clasped his hands behind his back and walked for a while, looking down at the road. "It does seem that something is called for," he said finally. "The trouble is that violence just leads to more violence, so I don't know." Dune's team was assigned to the cornfield that day. He and his father spent hours on their knees, yanking, pricking weeds out of the ground. Dune's arms itched. He kept having to stop to scratch it. Was a mosquito biting him? He scratched and scratched again. It felt like 50 mosquito bites, not one. He He had them on his other arm too, but both arms itched like crazy. Finally, he stopped working and held his arms out in front of him. From wrist to elbow, they were carpeted with red lumps. "Look, father," he cried, "I have a rash. What is it?" "I don't know, son," his father said, "but I have it too." The itchy rash spread over the arms and hands and faces of all of them brides who had helped with the cleanup that morning. "What is this?" people said as they worked in the bakery and the bike shop, the brickyard and the tomato fields. They itched, they scratched, and the rash spread and oozed and itched still more. The villagers knew what it was. "Poison oak," they said. They explained about the oil on the leaves, how you only had to touch it to get the rash. "You must have been out scrambling around in the woods," they said. But the Embrys had not been scrambling in the woods. They knew how they'd been poisoned. Someone had done it to them on purpose. Fury spread among the Embrys like a fire. Those who'd heard about the poison oak raged about it to those who hadn't. And before long, everyone knew. Diggers threw down their shovels. Fruit pickers pushed the ladders to the ground and stalked out of the orchard. Someone in the bakery flung a great clump of dough at the supervisor, and someone in the egg shop hurled 3 eggs at the wall. The terrible itching aggravated everyone's anger, and before long, the people of Amber began to gather in the streets and in the plaza. The gathering became a crowd, and the crowd became a mob. Dune ran into the village with the other field workers, and he found himself in the middle of this mob. He heard Tig's voice from somewhere nearby. "They gave us poison. What shall we give them?" When there was no response but a confused babble, the question came again louder. "What shall we give them?" This time the answer came, a crash and a tingling of shattering glass. Someone had thrown a rock through the window of the town hall. Cheers arose, and all around him, Dune saw people suddenly bending over, looking for rocks to throw. More crash, more yell. People started snatching things from the stalls. A jar of jam came sailing overhead. Arms reached out to catch it, but it fell past them and landed a few feet from Dune, smashing open and splattering his legs with sticky red goo and splinters of glass. He saw people stuffing muffins into their pockets and saw Tick with his arms stretched backward, ready to throw a rock at the window of the tower. He saw Miss Thorne running with her hands shielding her head and the Hoover sisters backing up into the egg shop trying to get away. He was frightened suddenly. At the moment, the doors of the town hall opened and Ben Barlow strode out. His face was twisted with rage. "Stop them," he shouted. "Stop these thieves and vandals." "You poisoned us," shouted someone in the crowd. "We've had enough," shouted someone else, and threw a potato right at Ben. It hit him in his stomach, and he bent over, his mouth dropping open. A roar came from the crowd. Tick's voice rose above the others. "Fill your pockets," he screamed. "Fill your pockets and run." There was a mad scramble, and then the Embrites pushed their way out of the plaza and raced down the streets to the river road. Dune ran too. He saw Tick up ahead of him, sprinting fast, his shirt tails flying. "Now we really are thieves and vandals," Dune thought. Was this a bad thing, or was it exactly what people of Sparks deserved? That night, Tick went up and down the corridors of the hotel, knocking on doors and urging people to come to his meeting. They did come, at least hundreds of them. By Dune's count, they gathered at the head of the road, and as the daylight was fading, Dune saw Chet and Gil and Allie and Alvin from his old class at the Ember School, along with people he knew from the pipeworks, people he knew from Ember's shops, and others. Most of them were boys and men, but there were women and girls too. Most were silent, but some whispered excitedly to each other. They formed a semicircle in front of Tick, who had climbed onto the street stump. Dune saw Lizzie standing near Tick, gazing up at him wide-eyed. The moon shone behind Tick's head. It gave a silver edge to his hair, but left his face in the darkness. "All right," Tick said. His voice was quiet, but instantly the whispering stopped. "Our time has come. They have attacked us 3 times now. Today we showed them a little of our anger. We made them understand that we won't be taken advantage of anymore. They must know that if they hurt us, they will be hurt too. We will strike back. We are warriors now. Murmurs of approval rumbled through the crowd. Dune, who was standing at the rear, heard several people echo Tick's words. "Strike back. Yes, we have to strike back. We are warriors. We must be ready," Tick said. "When the next confrontation comes, we won't be as disorganized as we were today. We'll have a plan and we'll be armed." More murmurs and a ripple of excitement. "How will we arm ourselves?" Tick asked. He answered the question himself. "We have what we need right here where we live," he said. "Look at your bathrooms. You'll find strong metal rods there, just the right length and enough for everyone." People looked at each other in puzzlement. Metal rods in the bathroom? But Dune knew immediately what Tick meant. The towel rack. "Take them off the walls and you have a sturdy weapon that could do real damage, bruise soft flesh, even break hard bone." Tick waited until the word was passed through the crowd and everyone understood about the weapons in the bathroom. Then he said, "There are other ways to arm yourself too. Did you bring a knife with you from Ember? Are there still slivers of glass left in the windows of your room? Have you noticed that some of the stones by the river are just the size to fit in a fist?" Again, he waited. All around Dune, people were nodding and whispering. Dune tried to imagine what the uprising earlier that day would have been like if the rioters had been swinging steel rods and striking out with knives and broken glass. People would have been hurt. There would have been blood. But think of the hurt of the village had inflicted on the Emberites. The pangs of hunger, the humiliation, the name-calling, the terrible city, the terrible itchy rash. Didn't one hurt deserve another? Wasn't he simply being squeamish to shrink from it? He would have to strengthen himself, he thought, not just his body, but his spirit, his will. It would take a kind of strength he didn't have yet to strike another person with the intent to harm. Tick was bending forward now and speaking in a soft voice. People slushed each other and listened. "Go back now and sleep, my warriors," Tick said. "In the next days, prepare your weapons and prepare your will. Remember how you felt when you saw those ugly words scrawled on your walls. Remember how you felt when the poison rash crawled up your arm. The people of Sparks will wrong us again. We can be sure of that. When it happens, we'll be ready." After the meeting, Dune walked back to the hotel feeling vaguely uneasy. Tick must be right, but somehow Dune couldn't feel wholehearted about being a warrior. Was it because he was a coward? He didn't want to be a coward. He didn't really think he was one. What was his problem then?